Hello everyone, welcome to 292 Baby Educational Videos. I'm Jim Coffey. I'm a communication professor here at Monroe Community College and the founder of 292 Baby. We always take different topics, but they're always focused on early childhood. And today's topic, which I think will be very important for anyone who's caring for newborns or infants, is on infants sleeping safely. And we are thrilled to have with us today Dr. Elizabeth Murray. And Elizabeth, thank you so much for joining us
today. Thank you. I'm honored to be here.
Would you mind just to give me a little background?
Sure. I grew up here in Rochester, and when I was done with my training, wanted to come back and work where I lived. I'm a pediatrician. I trained in pediatrics, and then I went on and did a fellowship in pediatric emergency medicine. So my primary responsibility is taking care of sick and injured children in the emergency department, but I also work in the Child Advocacy Center, at the Bavona Child Advocacy Center, too.
Okay. How did you get into pediatrics?
I've just always known. For some reason, I started off, I was a volunteer firefighter, and got involved in emergency medicine that way. And I just remember sitting in my college dorm room as a 19-year-old thinking, pediatric emergency medicine, that's what I would like to do. And I plotted out the time, and I thought, I'm going to be really old when it's done. And now I think, uh-oh, I've been doing it for 10 years, so now I must be really, really old.
Yeah, and it's all relative,
the age part. Sure. Compared to 19, I'm older.
Our topic today, infant sleeping safely.
Critically important.
Is it important?
You
I mean,
bet it is.
And why?
Sure, because it's an easy way to save a life.
Okay.
If I could tell you something else to do that was that easy to save a life, I'm sure you'd be happy to do it. We know that, unfortunately, in Monroe County, unsafe sleep environments are the leading cause of preventable death for infants. So anybody less than 1 year of age, the leading cause of preventable death
that's
is
the number
unsafe
one
sleep.
Leading cause.
Yep.
Okay, so that's huge.
Oh, yeah.
So, I mean, if I would think that if any one thing you could do to actually prevent a death, why not do it?
Right. If I told you that there was something out there in the world or a medicine that was killing this many children and all you had to do was pull it from the market, you'd say, of course, get rid of that. There's no way we're going to do it. Same idea here.
Okay. Now, I'm sure that a lot of parents think, what would be a safer time than a baby in an infant, you know, or a baby in a crib or with their parents or whatever? Just that seems to be a very safe time. So what is it about it that's not safe?
Well, and you're exactly right. Everyone is entering into parenthood with the very best intentions. Of course, you love that child more than anything possible. Until you're a parent, you don't really realize how much you can love another human being. And everybody is trying to do the very, very best, and they're doing what they think is the most loving and the most caring for that child. But we know that, unfortunately, being in a crib that also has bumpers or pillows or blankets or stuffed animals or other objects is very unsafe, because little babies just do not have the ability to move things out of their way.
I cringe when I hear that, because my kids are in their 20s now, but when they were little, we had a lot of stuff in the cribs, you know, and my daughter had a little blankie even in her first year that I just put her right into the crib with that. And now, that was something that I really shouldn't do.
And you know, it's not that necessarily things have changed that much, but there's a lot of people that were lucky. And you think about the accidents and the lives lost before we used seatbelts and before we used car seats, and a lot of people did live, but unfortunately a lot of people did not.
Yeah.
And we know that this is a simple thing that will help save lives.
Yep. Now what is it, I mean, it seems so safe. What is it that's unsafe about it? You say bumpers and things in the crib.
So a little brand new baby, you know, think about what they can do. Not much. What do we ask from them? We ask them to sleep and eat and grow and get their little brains to develop and work. But they don't have head control. They don't have ability to really use their hands in a way that's meaningful, meaning they can't say, hey, something's on my face, I have to move it down. Their heads are very, very big compared to the rest of their body, so they're really, really heavy and hard to move, even if they could control them. So simply having a blanket or a sheet accidentally cover their face will cause a suffocation. Having too many things around them could cause them to rebreathe. You know, as we exhale, we breathe out gases that our body does not want inside of us. And if we don't have the ability to have a nice open space around our faces, you can breathe some of those gases back in. So if a little baby is unable to clear their head or move away, they're going to start rebreathing some of those gases, and that's incredibly dangerous.
So they breathe out, and then they can, if they don't have the room, they can breathe back in.
Correct.
And they, in a sense, poison themselves with their own breath. That strikes me, too, that if they were sleeping with someone, someone else's breath, can that cause it, too, as well?
It's hard to know. I guess you'd have to be really right close at them. It, it's going to be the circulation of fresh air moving around them. But I think it's important to realize that many people assume that, oh, the reason it's not safe to have a baby sleep with you is because somebody's going to roll over on them. And yes, that does happen sometimes, but it's more common to have a much more subtle thing happen, such as a sheet or a blanket or a pillow, or perhaps an infant's arm gets stuck under a parent, and so then they're too close to the parent, and then that rebreathing phenomenon occurs.
Yep.
It's not just that a parent, their body is rolling over on the child. It's the whole environment. Mm-hmm. It's not safe for the baby.
I guess I always thought that the real danger of sleeping with the baby was that rolling mm-hmm. over part. Mm-hmm. I wonder if most people think that.
I think they do, and I think a lot of times people think, oh, if it's happening, it must be because they're overweight, or mm-hmm. that person must have had a glass of wine before they went to bed, or mm-hmm. something else. And really, the data just does not show that at all.
Yeah.
These are thin, healthy people that are doing everything right from their own health perspective. They mm-hmm. aren't making bad decisions, and they're certainly not entering into it thinking, I'm putting my child at risk. They're they're doing the very best thing for their child.
Sure. When my firstborn, he hid night and day backwards for about 7 months.
Exhausting.
It was. We were walking zombies, you know, for about 7 months, my wife and I.
Mm-hmm.
But to give her a rest, I would take my son downstairs, mm-hmm. and I would sleep on the couch, and I would actually put him right on me. You know, and I think now and again, mm-hmm. I cringe thinking what possibly could have happened, because...
Right.
And it's the issue of breathing. It's not
the issue
of breathing.
Crushing. The situation you mentioned, you know, he could have slipped down and fallen.
Mm-hmm.
He could come down and get wedged between the cushions of the couch and you,
mm-hmm.
or again, just fallen down completely onto the ground, perhaps hit his head on the way down. So lots of issues potentially with that. Issue with breathing temperature regulation. And you mentioned, you know, walking zombies. I think it's important to realize that we know, looking at other type of sleep data, that in adults, even a person who's got mild to moderate sleep deprivation, which I think it's fair to say every parent of a mm-hmm. new infant has at least mild sleep deprivation, that when we put them into a driving simulator, their ability to function is the same as somebody who's legally intoxicated. So mild to moderate sleep deprivation, your ability to function can be similar to somebody who's intoxicated.
That's amazing to
me. So it doesn't mean you don't have to have that glass of wine. Your sleep is so disturbed simply by being a parent, because it's exhausting. It's the hardest job ever. Your sleep cycle is like that baby's, and that baby's getting up every 2 hours.
Yeah.
And so you're right along with them for you know, more than 2 hours of sleep a night.
So the whole 7 months, my wife and I were zombies.
Yeah.
We were driving around like drunks.
Well, you know, I won't
okay.
go there.
Yeah. Well, you don't know my wife's driving habits. No, I shouldn't say that. So this is a real serious problem, but we're mm-hmm. talking about the child suffocating.
Talking about the child suffocating, that would be the risk. And this, it's important to mention that this is completely separate from SIDS.
Okay.
And so there's a lot of terminology, a lot of abbreviations that can be confusing when it comes to this topic. So mm-hmm. SIDS is sudden infant death syndrome.
Mm-hmm.
And that is something where, despite rigorous autopsy, testing, forensic evaluation of the scene, there's been no cause that's been determined, that no matter what, they cannot determine why this baby unfortunately passed away.
Mm-hmm.
And that would be different than a sudden, unexpected infant death.
Mm-hmm.
So again, more terminology. That situation, an unexpected death, would be one where a child could, heaven forbid, die of asphyxiation or suffocation,
mm-hmm.
or perhaps did have some previously undiagnosed anatomy difference, heart problem,
mm-hmm.
something like that. So there's this other category of these sudden, unexpected death, but then they go on to actually mm-hmm. have a cause. So unsafe sleep is more in that category, which is totally separate from SIDS.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of confusion between the two, because the things that we do to help encourage safe sleep are also believed to help encourage, reduce the likelihood of SIDS.
Mm-hmm.
But as time goes on, we think that the reduction in SIDS is really a reduction in unsafe sleep deaths. We're just better at determining the causes and looking at those association deaths.
All right, so those are two really very different.
Right.
Very different.
Sound
things.
Very similar.
Yeah.
Easy to use the terminology covering both, but they're totally separate issues.
And if I'm understanding you right, then the group that is the unexpected deaths,
mm-hmm.
far more of those are preventable.
Correct.
Okay.
Or have a cause. You know, preventable mm-hmm. from a safe sleep standpoint, but some have a cause. You know, sometimes these unexpected deaths are babies who have awful heart conditions that were
mm-hmm.
unknown, or have something very different about their ability to metabolize things.
Mm-hmm.
You know, different inborn errors that were not known about until the child gets into crisis.
Yeah. Okay. So you're a parent, and you talked about no blankets, no,
mm-hmm.
no little toys.
Yeah,
little
you're not
critter.
Neglecting the child. You're doing the very best thing for your child. It's easy to look at that baby in an empty bassinet or empty
mm-hmm.
crib and thinking, that looks awful in there. I'm just leaving the baby alone. And that's not the case at all. Actually, by keeping your baby safe, that's the ultimate show of love for that child.
Okay, all right. And there's an irony that they're really trying to love their children.
Right.
What we're going to do right now is we're going to listen to some stories of some parents who have unfortunately gone through this awful thing. And I just can't even imagine how bad that would be.
The strength that they have to share these stories, I think, is amazing.
Yeah. So let's take a break and go to that.
Great.
Rashad, like all my other kids, they slept with me. We'd put, you know, the babies in the bed with us, and my husband and myself. And that night, we put Rashad in the bed with us. He was actually in between both of us. He was fairly young, maybe 6 weeks old. And we put him in the middle of us that night before we went to bed. He was a beautiful baby. He was very, very beautiful. He was born on May 12th. And he was a good baby. He was 6 weeks old, but he was not a crier. He didn't cry a lot. He was just beautiful. He was a beautiful little boy. And again, you know, sleeping with him, I felt close when my children were in the bed with me, you know, with him near. And I have a memory of his smell. I can smell what he smelled like. I walked into the room. And I just remember him holding the baby. And he was crying. My husband was crying. And I didn't know what exactly had happened. But I knew that he was dead. And all I could do is, I kind of like stood there for a minute. I was scared. I was very scared. I didn't know what had actually happened to him. So I was afraid. I didn't know. And to see him holding him, and then when I walked towards him and picked the baby up from him, took the baby out of his arms, I just remember how cold he was, and I felt really, really bad. I don't know how else to explain it, that feeling of just like your whole world had just caved in on you. I was young. I didn't understand a lot of things. And I just wanted to know what happened to Rashad. I just didn't know what happened. It makes me feel really responsible. It makes me feel like I'm responsible for his death, that I could have possibly prevented that if I'd have known to do things differently. So I feel guilty sometimes about that, that, you know, there was a better way to do things.
I had put Riley to bed before I left, and it was one of those things where I was kind of like, I really shouldn't go. I really didn't want to leave them. And, you know, he was just like, no, you need to go. They're going to be fine. Just go. While I was gone, I was just like, something's not right. Like, I could just feel it. I was home by midnight, and I walked into the house, and I walked upstairs and looked over to my left where the couch was, thinking maybe he fell asleep out there and she was crying. I didn't hear anything. Nobody was on the couch. So I walked down to the bedroom and turned the light on and immediately looked at the pack and play, and Riley wasn't in the pack and play. And I looked over and Tom was in the bed with Audrina in his right arm, and then Riley was in his left arm. And Riley was turned, his arm was up, and Riley was on her side and her face was turned into his side right here, and her right arm was stuck underneath him. So I immediately just grabbed her, and she was black and blue in the face. She was ice cold. So I started screaming.
I had fallen asleep with both of them in my arms, and I woke up to Tori screaming that Riley wasn't breathing. And my first instinct was, what are you talking about? And she was screaming. She was on the phone with 911. And it was shortly after that that the ambulance had showed up, and they were doing CPR on her. And that's when they had taken her out of the house, and that I thought for sure, I was like, yeah, they'll bring her back. They'll bring her back. This can't happen. This can't be happening right now. And it was just the worst feeling in the world. There was nothing I could do. Because I always believe if something's wrong, I can fix it. God usually believes that if it's broken, you can fix it. This was something I couldn't fix. I couldn't even touch her.
But I've never blamed him for it. Honestly, I felt more blame on myself for not being there.
I don't see how she couldn't. I blame me.
Welcome back, everyone. I'm Jim Coffey, and I'm with Dr. Elizabeth Murray, and we are talking about safe sleep for infants and newborns. And Elizabeth, we've just watched a video of parents who unfortunately have gone through what an awful thing. As a parent, I just can't imagine
it's
anything
awful.
Worse.
I've met those people. I applaud them for their strength, for sharing their stories. Mm-hmm. It kills me every time I see them.
Yeah.
It's just excruciating.
Yeah, it's the kind of thing that you just... Well, I think probably for anyone, the loss of a mm-hmm. child has to be one of the most traumatic mm-hmm. experiences to go through. And, yeah. and we're talking about preventing that loss. And so
right.
I do applaud them too for going
right.
out and kind of having to relive that. Mm-hmm. But if they've mm-hmm. helped prevent anyone else from going through it, it's worth it. So let's go back to the idea of the safe sleep. One mm-hmm. of the things that strikes me is that people who are breastfeeding mm-hmm. would often think this is the most natural thing, that I would just can mm-hmm. breastfeeding and they gotta be tired.
Yep.
That the baby would just sleep right there with them.
Yeah. Well, breastfeeding, you're right. Breastfeeding is natural, but natural does not mean easy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And breastfeeding, in addition to being a parent, is a really, really challenging skill. Mm-hmm. And it does add to the exhaustion of normal parenting. But it's important to remember that breastfeeding is really a completely separate issue from safe sleep.
Mm-hmm.
It is perfectly appropriate to breastfeed as much as you can, as much as your baby needs.
Mm-hmm.
But what we ask is that when you're done with the breastfeeding, that you just reach next to you and put your baby down in a bassinet or in their own sleep environment instead mm-hmm. of falling asleep with the child in bed with you. Mm-hmm. It really is not that much of a difference in the maneuver or anything versus just staying still mm-hmm. or just reaching down next to you to put the baby in a bassinet. That child, for their safety, needs to be in their own dedicated sleep environment.
So if I'm understanding you right, I'm in the bed.
Yep.
There's a crib or a bassinet or something right up
yep.
next to the bed.
So that's what we know is the safest thing, is mm-hmm. to have a baby in your same sleep room, but not in your own same sleep space.
Mm-hmm.
So co-sleeping usually refers to having a baby in the same sleep space with you, meaning you or another adult or a sibling as well, and that baby together in with adult bedding, mm-hmm. you know, pillows, sheets, blankets. What we need is to have a baby in their own dedicated sleep environment so they are protected from those blankets or maybe your arm accidentally falling over on their mm-hmm. face. So whether it be a bassinet or a co-sleeping device that attaches to the bed or a crib right in the same mm-hmm. environment so you can get to them very, very quickly. We want that baby to be close to you because we want to do anything we can to help facilitate breastfeeding.
Mm-hmm.
But we need to have them be in their own sleep environment for their own safety and then also for the development of their own what we call sleep hygiene.
Mm-hmm.
We don't mean sleeping dirty. We mean developing their own normal, healthy sleep patterns mm-hmm. to carry them on actually through life.
And how long does it take them to develop these habits?
Well, for the first 6 months of life, babies are just kind of growing and getting the routine down. We know mm-hmm. that once a baby is about 6 months of age, they can start to form habits. And it's more than that. I think you really need to appreciate that from a baby's brain standpoint, everything that they're taking in, everything they're learning is forming their reality.
Mm-hmm.
And it might sound dramatic, but it's really the case.
Mm-hmm.
I used to work with a doctor who'd say, if you went into your child's room every night and stood on your head and counted to 10 in Chinese, that would be their reality.
Mm-hmm.
And if all of a sudden you stopped, it would be very disturbing because that's what they considered normal.
Mm-hmm.
You or I would think that's crazy. Nobody does
mm-hmm.
that.
Yep.
But for that child, that would be their baseline. That would be their reality. So if you've always had that baby sleep in bed with you and then all of a sudden try to move them
mm-hmm.
to a different sleep environment once they've formed that habit, once that's become their reality, it's going to be incredibly disturbing for them and
mm-hmm.
very hard to then overcome. part of your brain growing is learning, all right, I wake up, I'm okay, I'm safe, it's still night, I need to fall back to sleep.
Mm-hmm. So consistency with the routine mm-hmm. is very important
Incredible.
For that. Yeah, mm-hmm. okay. And if a parent, if they're putting in, into a bassinet, you got it right up there, the same rules apply? Nothing in the bassinet?
Correct.
No.
Yep, a firm mattress, a firm, tight-fitted mm-hmm. sheet. You can put your baby in a type of sleep sack or an infant sleep device, which is kind of like a little baby sleeping bag. Mm-hmm. And the reason those are nice is because it will actually help with warmth, but it is unable to then accidentally go over their face. Mm-hmm. So that's an approved sleep device as
and
well.
And does that happen that they might just roll over and put their hand over their own mouth or somehow block the breathing?
Their hands themselves, it would be unusual to mm-hmm. have that impede their breathing mm-hmm. at all. But we wouldn't want a baby to move and have a loose blanket accidentally come up and cover their face or part of their face.
Okay. Now, it strikes me that it would be different in terms of what I would consider in the first couple months of life mm-hmm. when they're not moving much, and then
right.
a little bit older, it would be different then.
Right.
What time frame are we talking about for the safety here?
Well, we know that statistically, the majority of deaths occur in the first 4 months of life, mm-hmm. and that coincides with when babies can do the least. By four months of age, babies usually rolling, and so you do the best you can. You put their baby on their back to sleep to start, mm-hmm. and that baby very well might roll over through the night, and that's okay because they've started to develop their own ability to move. We still want to limit the things mm-hmm. in their environment because they're not going to have the greatest ability to say, I have to move this away from me.
Yep.
But once they start to move on their own, and certainly once they start to sit up, if mm-hmm. they need a little stuffed animal or some mm-hmm. other type of little comforting buddy with them in their bed, then that's okay. But they need to be much older.
And what age is that? Where you can
more like 6 months, 6 to 8 months.
Okay.
Where you can have a little stuffed animal, a little lovey, a little something
yep.
to snuggle in with them.
Yeah, okay. I think culturally, mm-hmm. many people believe that it's just the most natural thing in the world, and that if they don't have the baby sleep with them, they're not loving their baby.
Mm-hmm.
Do you find that true, that it's tied to different cultures within?
We do. We do, and you know, everybody again wants to just do the right thing.
Sure.
Everybody's trying to do the right thing, and mm-hmm. of course, families are going to turn to extended members of their family for advice.
Mm-hmm.
You know, grandmothers have been through it, and so they can often be a great resource for you. But I think you need to remember there's a difference between getting advice and tips versus getting factual information about something that can really impact a mm-hmm. child's health and welfare.
Yep.
And so I think that in general, when it comes to feeding a baby, tips on car seat safety, tips on sleep, those mm-hmm. are all things that can have very significant impacts on a child's life.
Sure.
You need to go to the trusted resources and medical providers for that.
Mm-hmm.
If your baby's really fussy and you call your mom and say, give me some ideas of what mm-hmm. I can do to help with my fussy baby, grandmothers and relatives are great for that kind of stuff and to help you out with and just to kind of coach you along and give you the support you need. But when it comes to the things that are going to impact livelihood and health,
yeah.
We need to go to our trusted resources
yep,
for that.
Okay, and this being one of them. So, yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So, if so now I'm a parent or I'm watching this, I'm a parent mm-hmm. or a grandparent or anybody who's actually caring
right.
for infants and that, it strikes me that they might just say, you know, why didn't I hear anything? You know, wouldn't they make a noise that they're
right.
starting to suffocate?
And that is such a common thing. And we know that, unfortunately, we hear time and time again in the setting of drownings or mm-hmm. other accidents every single time the parent says, but I didn't hear a thing. It was silent. I didn't hear a thing. I should have heard something.
You do hear that,
and
yeah.
We hear it every single time, unfortunately.
Yeah.
And just there is no noise. This is a silent killer.
Yeah.
And that's because the baby cannot struggle. They cannot move. They cannot do the things they need to do to protect themselves.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so you can't hear it.
Mm-mm.
It's oh boy. Okay, so we can see that it's a huge problem. It really is a problem of breathing,
mm-hmm.
of actually having the breathing cut off somehow, whether mm-hmm. it's a blanket or a toy or anything. It changes a little bit from the very beginning of life, but you
yep.
said most deaths from this are in the first 4 months?
Unfortunately, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
The littlest ones.
So let's maybe focus right down on what do parents need to know to really prevent this? What are some of the top...
Great. So the very simplest thing is dedicated sleep environment, fancy term for just having the baby have their own crib or their own bassinet.
Mm-hmm.
And what's going on in that bassinet or crib is important too. So we want that to just be a firm mattress with a tight fitted sheet, no bumpers, no blankets, no toys, no comforters, that beautiful bedding set that you got for your baby shower.
Yeah.
Most of it can go in the closet or save a lot of money and just mm-hmm. get the sheets. You don't need all the stuff that goes with it.
I can just, sorry to interrupt, but I can just hear a lot of parents saying,
yeah.
it's like I'm not doing anything for my baby. I feel like I've got to do something for them. So right. they have to fight that
right.
idea.
Well, but you are. I mean, you have to remember you are mm-hmm. doing the very best thing for your baby yeah. by keeping them
yeah.
safe.
Okay.
It's not a matter of comfort, soft. Mm-hmm. Soft does not equal comfort if you're a baby. Soft okay. equals unsafe.
Okay.
So you need a firm mattress.
Okay.
And then we know that the most critical thing actually is to have the baby on their back to sleep. On their back to sleep, mm-hmm. on their back to sleep. They have to be on their back to sleep. And their head is going to be fine. Babies' heads might flatten out a little bit early on, and people get worried about that, but that fixes over time, so
okay.
don't worry.
So whenever you're putting the baby into the bed,
yep.
or the bassinet, not
yep.
the bed, the bassinet or the crib,
yes.
it's on their back?
Yep, dedicated
Always.
Sleep environment, on their back to sleep.
Okay.
Yes.
Right.
And so, you know, you might be out driving and your baby falls asleep in the car seat, fine, for a few minutes or a little bit of time, mm-hmm. and that's okay. But you don't want to come home and then let the baby continue to sleep in the car seat. They need to transition from the car seat to a place where they should be sleeping. So that is a bassinet or a crib, mm-hmm. pack and play, some type of thing with a firm, flat base to it. On their back to sleep.
Okay, all right. So those are the biggest two things.
Yep.
All right, a clean environment, back to sleep.
boring, and more boring.
No, but
yeah.
but critical.
Yes.
Critical. Anything
yeah.
else?
Some other things people wouldn't really think about. We don't want the environment to be too hot, just to be comfortable environment.
Mm-hmm.
There's some information showing that actually pacifiers with sleep can
mm-hmm.
help. We know that breastfeeding is great for babies, and
mm-hmm.
that's a good thing for overall health
mm-hmm.
And safety there. We know that parents should not smoke before the child is conceived
mm-hmm.
while they're pregnant, and then no smoking in the household or by either parent after the child is born as well.
Okay. We've got just a few moments left. Any final thoughts?
You know, we're not trying to scare everybody. We're not trying to come up with yet another thing that you have to worry about.
Mm-hmm.
Being a parent is full of worry anyways.
Mm-hmm.
But yet this is so simple and
mm-hmm.
something that when you're exhausted and you can't think anymore, this needs to just be ingrained in your brain.
Yeah.
Back to sleep in their own sleep environment.
Yeah.
Your last thought as you fall asleep is my baby in their own sleep mm-hmm. environment? Are they safe on their back? Okay, I can sleep now.
Okay. Great way to end. Dr. Elizabeth Murray, thank you so much for joining us. And thank you all for joining us on this edition of 292 Baby Educational Videos. Thanks for joining us.
Baby sleeps is a matter of life and death. In 2012, the Monroe County Health Department declared unsafe sleep the leading preventable cause of death for healthy infants under the age of one. Babies are safe when they sleep alone on their back in an approved crib or bassinet with a firm mattress covered by a fitted sheet. No blankets, no pillows, no bumpers, no toys. For more information on safe sleep for your baby, contact the Baby Safe Sleep Coalition today. It just might save your baby's life.